Everybody, it's 1 minute past 10. We shall kick off this session now, if that's okay. I'm delighted to be joined by Lord Bernard Hogan Howe and Fran Murray from Rosenblatt Law, who are going to be conducting this presentation with myself, Tom Townsend, from GT's financial crime team. The subject matter is financial crime and financial crime resilience. So we're going to take you through a few of the hot topics that are out there at the moment, some of the issues that some of our clients are facing, and hopefully we'll have a great session. As I've mentioned before, we're using slido.com throughout the presentation. So if you would like to answer any questions that we ask throughout this, Slido is the way to do that. If you go on to Slido and use hashtag FinCrime, you'll see that we're going to be asking you, polling you for some questions and some answers throughout this session, and you'll have the opportunity to answer those questions. And in the opposite direction, if you'd like to ask us some questions, that will be moderated by Emma on the call, and we will go through those at the end. Then more than happy to. I should also pre-advertise that this is one session of a number that are coming at the end of this presentation. We'll talk through just very briefly some of the other sessions that are going to form part of this series. So you can also, I should say, submit questions using Teams if you would like to, if you have a burning question, for us to moderate them. It's probably better if it comes via Slido. So if you can use Slido, that would be preferable to us. But feel free, if you've got a burning question that you need to ask and you want to do it via Teams, then please feel free to do so. Emma, if we could go on to the next slide. Okay, so without further ado, why don't I hand over to Fran Murray? We're very pleased to have her on this call today, and she's going to take us through some financial crime hot topics as they are at the moment. And then that will be followed by Lord Hogan Howe and then myself. We hope that it will turn into something discursive and interactive, but we will see how that goes. But Fran, over to you.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us this morning. I hear we have a great turnout. This is the first in a series of four on financial crime. My name's Fran Murray. I'm a financial crime lawyer. I both defend and privately prosecute. I assisted in founding the financial crime department for Rosenblatt, and we also have here the advisor to the financial crime department, Lord Hogan Howe, who, as Tom said, you will hear from very shortly. In terms of my background, over the last 13 years, I have defended multi-million pound, multi-jurisdictional frauds investigated by the Serious Fraud Office, HMRC, and the Financial Conduct Authority. We represent anything from the ultra high net to the high net worth individual through to the limited company and the PLC. In terms of private prosecutions, again, we represent individuals and companies who have been the victims of fraud. For today's purposes, I'm going to be cherry picking three key topic areas that have featured during the course of the pandemic: furlough fraud, impersonation scams, and supply chain fraud and counterfeiting. These are just some general statistics on financial crime and financial crime offending during the pandemic. So in mid-April 2020, global cases of financial crime hit a daily peak of almost 100,000, and there's nearly 2 million by the end of April. So obviously, it has increased exponentially during this period. People always say that where there's a crisis, there is fraud, and there are very sophisticated fraudsters who can very quickly put together a scam and exploit a desperate situation where people are panicked and potentially in financial dire straits, as we've seen during the course of the months with the economy and the decline and the loss of jobs. So we've got our interactive poll. The financial crime levy a proposal was made in the budget in March by the Chancellor. There's a consultation paper currently underway. This is an effort to have a public and private partnership to tackle financial crime and money laundering. And obviously, because there's been an increase, this will be particularly important. So if you just want to vote on there as to whether you think a financial crime levy will successfully tackle money laundering.
So for those of you who have joined since we kicked off, we're using Slido for the purposes of getting your feedback. And as Franna said, this is the first question that she's got in her slide. So if you go to slido.com, hashtag FinCrime, you'll both be able to respond to the poll and the questions that we're posing to you, but also you'll be able to ask some questions which we will deal with at the end. We have a slot at the end for questions, and so that would be very helpful if you're able to use Slido as a vehicle for doing that. Back to you, Fran.
Thank you very much, Tom. So as Tom has rightly said, if you can use slido.com to vote, and we will see what the response is to, do you think the proposals for a financial crime levy will successfully tackle money laundering? If we can lock the poll. So we've got 58% have no confidence in the government whatsoever, which I'm not surprised at the moment. So, as I said, it's still in consultation, and we will see what happens when it closes circa 13th of October. So furlough fraud, what is it? You probably will have heard a lot about it over the last few months. It was to save those that were at risk of losing their jobs. I think that a number of employers and employees may have been on the cusp of breaching some of the scheme's rules unknowingly in some cases, but in other cases there has been an outright abuse of the scheme. That's either by way of an employer furloughing staff and forcing them to work, otherwise they would face dismissal. Or a member of staff will only find out at the end of the month when they receive a reduced salary that they have been furloughed. Or even more extreme, organised crime gangs have been setting up fictitious companies in order to exploit the furlough scheme. And they have then sought to claim from the scheme for ghost employees. The scheme finishes at the end of October on the 31st, and then we have a new scheme, the job support scheme. So that's lots of opportunity for more fraud. I'm sure we will be hearing of more cases. That being said, there has been one arrest in respect to furlough fraud, and that was mid-June for a fraud that was totaling around £500,000. It was a company director. He had accounts frozen, assets seized, and nothing further has been heard as a result of that. So whether HMRC have decided to settle financially and they won't prosecute, the jury's out on that one. We can move on. So these are just some statistics on the losses that have been incurred during the course of the furlough scheme and furlough fraud. So up to 3.5 billion may have been claimed fraudulently or paid out in error. And as at September, there were 8,000 calls to HMRC's fraud hotline of complaints of furlough fraud. And in my own experience, a lot of those reports are made by the aggrieved employee, as employers have been not only breaching the scheme, but employment law rules in general. A number of businesses have pledged to return their furlough money, and you can see those businesses there, Taylor Wimpey, IKEA, Games Workshop, and so on. So if the audience could decide, again, as Tom had said on slido.com, hashtag FinCrime, as to whether you actually think HMRC will prosecute those that have committed furlough fraud, as we haven't seen any to date. However, the scheme is only closing at the end of October, so it may be that HMRC are waiting for that deadline in order to commence any prosecutions. And if we can lock the poll, please. So that's 64% of you do think that HMRC will prosecute, which means that criminal defence lawyers like myself or those that want to privately prosecute will be in lots of work. If we can move on.
Do you think, Fran, just as a question from Tom, do you think, I presume we would think that they would focus on some of the larger schemes, presumably, or is that not necessarily a given? What do you have any thoughts on?
In my view, I think that they would cherry pick the larger corporate entities that have blatantly abused the scheme in order to make an example. And obviously there is power in doing that and publicising it and making sure the media are ensuring that society are aware that HMRC do investigate and they are active, because the confidence has diminished over the last few years.
Great, thank you.
Impersonation scams. So another hot topic during the pandemic. What is an impersonation scam? Well, it's where criminals claim that they represent an organisation. And during this period, it's been predominantly HMRC or The Who when we were in the thick of the lockdown, because people were overly trusting at that time. Again, desperation and panic during the pandemic. This is unprecedented times. And people have been lured into parting with money that has been stolen by fraudsters. Can happen by telephone, email, text messages. So there have been nearly 15,000 impersonation scams reported by UK finance members between January and June 2020. And that's an increase of 84% in comparison with 2019. So clearly, again, fraudsters have exploited the pandemic period in order to steal money from those that have fallen for these scams. Push payment scams, it was in the news last week. This is an authorised push payment scam where the victim willingly transfers their money to the scammer. So fraudsters will ordinarily have hacked emails firstly to identify existing business relationships to give it a feel of authenticity. A scammer will then pretend to be from your bank or be your conveyancing solicitor in a property transaction that you're currently underway with, or a tradesperson that you have dealings with. There is no legal protection for customers who transfer their money in an authorised push payment scam. However, innocent victims who have used banks that have signed up to the voluntary code are entitled to be reimbursed if they have been a victim of this scam. A number of banks have signed up to the voluntary code, and that includes Barclays, HSBC, Lloyds, Metro, NatWest, Nationwide. And these scams are ongoing, so it's in everyone's best interest that one is extra vigilant, because the fraudsters are ever sophisticated and their scams are adapting to your daily life and transactions that are ongoing in your daily life in order to steal your money. So 207 million was lost to these scams between January and June. Again, a sign of the times with the pandemic and the exploitation of that. 47.9 million in compensation has been received under the voluntary code. The amounts lost are relatively nominal, as you will see. It's ordinarily under £1,000. However, banks who are signed up to the voluntary code can assist victims. So if you have been a victim of this kind of scam, or you're wanting to privately prosecute somebody who has perpetrated this scam, that's where Rosenblatt would be able to be engaged. Next slide, please. So there are a number of scams, and I'm mindful that we have a cyber session in the series, which is session 3, so I'm not going to go into phishing and vishing extensively. Phishing and vishing scams are extensive. They're ordinarily by email or telephone, where there is an interception of a telephone call and large sums of money are transferred. There was a vishing scam some years ago that was prosecuted in London, and a number of football clubs and law firms had handed over large sums of money as a result of vishing scams. That the perpetrators were caught, but these scams are ongoing, and more often than not, they are out of jurisdiction, so the perpetrator is harder to detect.
It's interesting, Fran. I've had an experience of a couple of those. I know some of the people on this call have heard some of my anecdotes before, but I've had two separate £7 million examples of this type of scam. For medium-sized, actually, corporates, and very sophisticated in how they get in behind some of the controls, or use the fact that some of the controls are not very good and manage to insert themselves in the payment pathway to receive payments that shouldn't be coming to them. And as you say, how quickly the money goes abroad, and making it a little bit more difficult to recover.
Absolutely.
Well, a lot more difficult, in fact.
But very much so. And also exploiting the weak link in an organisation, or somebody that may be more junior in an organisation that is susceptible, especially if it's over the telephone and seems authentic.
Yeah.
So there's some statistics on phishing and vishing, which I will go into more on our cyber session. We've got, an interactive poll question here, slido.com. #FinCrime. I'm interested to know, have you or someone you know been the victim of an impersonation scam during the pandemic? Interesting. So we must have a very savvy audience of lawyers and business professionals who are wise to the impersonation scam, which is good to know.
It's kind of interesting, isn't it, on that very topic, Fran, that there is a school of thought. We talk about vulnerability, and traditionally people have talked about vulnerability in terms of economic position or age or other vulnerabilities, you know, mental health difficulties and all these kinds of things. We talk about vulnerability in those terms, but there is a school of thought that is kind of gaining momentum that, you know, we are all vulnerable at different particular points of time in the week. And that the fraudsters and those that would do us harm are getting cleverer and cleverer at pinpointing the circumstances which might lead to vulnerability, even to professional people who are the group that is predominantly on this call.
Yeah, and law firms are susceptible, and all the way up to senior management. And you hear of stories where passwords are put on post-it notes on computers and so on. It still happens, unbelievably. So one has to be careful, even if you are in the know and aware and alive to these scams.
Yeah.
Finally, I'm aware of the time. Supply chain fraud and counterfeiting. Obviously, in the peak of the lockdown period, PPE was critical. And there was an exploitation of the supply chain because there was such a great need and demand during that period. If we moved on to the next slide. So early on in the pandemic, the figures were particularly high, and law enforcement was seizing counterfeit surgical masks, hand gels, things like potentially the cure to COVID, or testing kits that were all counterfeit. There was a well-known incident with the German health authorities where they had been duped into transferring 2.3 million euros for face masks. And that made people alive to the fact that even the German health authorities, the wider authorities overseas and onshore were at risk and were vulnerable to fraudsters and counterfeit goods. And still now, Europol and Interpol are still uncovering large shipments of PPE that are not fit for purpose, that have been purchased overseas in places like Singapore, the US, have been shipped over from China and other countries. So it is still ongoing. We don't know what's happening, whether there is a second wave around the corner, and supply chains are still vulnerable. Health authorities are still vulnerable. There is a lack of PPE, and there was in the thick of the lockdown. So fraudsters will cash in on that. Thank you very much. That's my part of this session. I'll move on to Lord Bernard Hogan Howe, advisor to Rosenblatt's Financial Crime Department.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity just to say a few words. First of all, just a brief introduction. Having been chief in Merseyside and then in the Met, one of the things I was always very keen on is pursuing economic crime, particularly connected to organised crime. So organised crime is crime committed for profit. And obviously, if you could take the profit out by good asset recovery, then you could reduce the attraction of economic crime. There's a massive amount to do there, but both in Merseyside and the Met, we did quite a lot. And in fact, in the Met, we had the largest economic crime unit in the country. And we also built the largest, interestingly, as Fran said, for the future events, the largest cybercrime unit in Europe, because that's one of the great facilitators, obviously, of economic crime. I just wanted to concentrate really on two factors which I think are particularly relevant today in terms of economic crime and are relevant at different aspects of either preventing it, detecting it, or if it comes to a court process, civil or criminal. And those two areas really are around people and intelligence gathering, and both are linked. And I wanted to concentrate first on the people part. Any organization's most precious asset is the other people it has. And we had about 50,000 people, and they were the ones who were going to deliver the service. They had to be supported by other things like IT, vehicles, all the rest of it. But at the end of the day, the most precious asset, obviously, are the people. And in terms of economic crime, any organization's biggest risk can be its own people who, one, whether it be phishing attacks or whether it be different types of economic crime attacks, have to be well recruited, well trained, and well selected for their roles. And sometimes people rush through that and don't say, actually, what do you mean by training? Do you train people to see phishing attacks? Do you share with them case studies of where it's gone wrong? Have you got a culture which encourages people to come forward and say, I think I made a mistake here? The aviation industry are particularly good at that, encouraging people to declare when they think they've made an error, because otherwise it can mean that, in fact, the way to discover the error is that, in fact, an attack has been successful, money's been lost, and there's a need to remedy the problem rather than prevent it. So the investment in people, particularly around training, I think is vital. And some organisations can see it as a cost. Good training is always an investment, and particularly in the area of economic crime, training people to recognise it and then to stop it is a vital investment. But the particular area I wanted to concentrate on in terms of people for organisations is around insider threat. So many economic crimes are facilitated by people who work in an organisation, or innocently or maliciously, information is shared about how systems work. So therefore, those systems can be avoided. And I suppose my challenge, for particularly for commercial organisations, as they look at this area, have they invested enough in it? One of the things we did in the police, both in the Met and in Merseyside, and most all police forces, is have our own units who only were dedicated to looking out for corrupt colleagues. The numbers of them weren't high, but they had been 40, 50 years ago. And our attempt was to stop conspiracies being arranged, or even to root out particular individuals. And I just thought it might be helpful to share some of the things that we did, which we found incredibly productive in terms of stopping recruiting these people, or alternatively getting rid of them, and sometimes prosecuting them. There are two areas in which we concentrated. The first was around human intelligence gathering, and the other was around the other type, which is SIGINT, technical intelligence gathering. They're the two broad types. And my point would be that the intelligence is kept in any organization in different areas. So, for example, the HR department can help hold certain intelligence about employees. It may be about sickness records. It may be about patterns of behaviour that have been spotted before. Local managers hold information. Whistleblowing lines are incredibly effective. In the Met, we had two whistleblowing lines, one within the organisation where people could anonymously report on concerns about colleagues. And we also had an arrangement with the charity who were a buffer between us and the people who rang in. And they anonymously gathered information which was shared back to the organisation to talk about, you know, risks that they perceived in colleagues. I, as head of the organisation, saw a list of all those reports every month. Obviously not who made the report and not even who directed the person it was about. I was always interested in spotting themes, were the common themes. Had we investigated it thoroughly, or had we done a half-baked job in trying to find out whether what was alleged was true? And I would argue that, you know, any organisation needs that whistleblowing line to, but also the people at the most senior level need to see it, to see if they've got a broad threat or if they've got particular things that they need to really get stuck into. You've also got customer complaints. We in the police had a department which dealt with complaints both from people who were victims and people who were suspects, differently motivated at times to make complaints. But we saw common facts between different complainants. It was either a conspiracy or there was something you needed to look at. Was an officer violent when making an arrest? Was there allegations of corruption against them? Were there allegations of drug taking? These were things that we needed to know. And the complaints sometimes told us that. Civil litigation from clients, and particularly in our case, victims and suspects, could give you more information, often a bit longer term. The civil litigation didn't arrive until sometimes years later. So it's vital you kept an eye on that to see what it was telling you about your own people. Employment tribunal data can give you information about your own colleagues, and clearly internal grievances. And how you manage all that intelligence together, because it may be if it's held in different parts of the organisation, you don't spot a pattern about a place that you have in your organisation, an individual, or a process. And it seems to me vitally important that one part of the organisation pulls all that together where you are considering an insider threat. And if you looked at the technical, the SIGINT part, then more and more now we've got the potential for looking at how computers are used or misused within the organisation, telephone usage. There's some indirect things you can look at. Are certain rooms are used out of sequence? If certain rooms are only supposed to be used between, let's say, 8 in the morning or 4 in the afternoon, and they suddenly start being used at 2 o'clock in the morning, what's happening there? There may be an innocent explanation, but do you know? And certainly with more and more access control to rooms and buildings, it's possible to look at how our buildings are being used, look at printing of documents, about the transfer of data between emails from within the organisation to outside. Do you know whether or not sensitive data is being shared to private emails? And if so, is it sharing information that really you do not want to lose out of your organisation? So all those things taken together, I think, can produce good intelligence. The second thing is, have you got a team to investigate, or do you leave it to the local manager? If it's left to the local manager, they may not have the experience or the resources to look at it thoroughly. So for me, investing in that area is usually very important. It helps to, therefore, to seize evidence and to make sure that you've got good systems in place to respond when an alert is made. And finally, it helps to identify where the data is held. Sometimes people don't always know where that data is held if there is an attack of any kind. And it's something I think we're looking at in the cyber crime program, is to know exactly where your data is held to understand where an economic crime attack may come. And the final thing, of course, is to look at asset tracking, which already has been said to be by Fran, that obviously the challenges of cross-jurisdictional recovery and sometimes actually corrupt jurisdictions. States in which you cannot rely on the government aid, the government systems, to help you with asset tracking or particularly its recovery. And the second area that I then want to talk about finally is, having talked about the people side and the the insider threat aspect that people need to keep an eye on in terms of economic crime, is public-private partnerships and the sharing of intelligence. Now, it seems to me that the big challenges at the moment, we've got a good system in the UK called Gimlet, which is a really good system for sharing around money laundering data. But it is a bit spasmodic. is probably the best in the world. However, it's still for me in the footholds of data sharing. And I think what the financial economic crime levy is going to give an opportunity to deliver when it is delivered, we hear about £100 million per year, is the potential for creating what I would term a clearinghouse for the exchange of data. So at the moment, it's quite difficult for the state to share with private entities their data about, for example, criminality. So both the police and the security service have a list of people they know have been criminals, they've been convicted, and they have a list of information about intelligence about people they suspect are criminals but haven't yet proved it. But it's pretty hard for them to share that with commercial entities. There's no protection for the sharing of that data easily, unless you get a court production order or all the other formal processes. But my point would be, it would be really helpful if private enterprise could have a look at the list of criminal intelligence to spot whether or not they're being attacked by criminal actors or their friends. And at the moment, that's a pretty difficult exercise. Apart from in individual cases, it's not systemic and it's not mass sharing of data. The second challenge in terms of sharing of data, I would argue, is that commercial entities have struggled to share data between their peers. The insurance industry has addressed it very, very well. And they did that because they needed to spot fraud. They needed to spot duplicate applications for insurance about the same event. And consequently, they've come up with a really good data sharing system that allows them the corporate benefit of sharing the data is better than the risk they run if they don't share it. And I'm afraid whether it be financial institutions, banks, really, I think, have struggled to share this. But if you had a clearinghouse, both the state and peer-to-peer sharing of data could be better. What it would need, of course, is that there would be have to be privacy protection in place there. There's got to be protection of commercial sensitivities. There's also got to be protection of law enforcement assets in terms of techniques and skills. But also there's commercial sensitivity about their own commercial methods, which would have to be protected in such an environment. But if we're able to overcome those things, and I believe we can with the right investment, this economic levy, then what that allows us to do is to, amongst the data, spot patterns of behaviour which are indicative of financial crime. It helps us to spot criminal behaviour directly, and it helps us to spot just unusual activity. If we get that system in place, then the possibility then exists to higher the bar for suspicious activity reports, SARs. At the moment, we all know that 99.9% of SAR reports are of innocent activity, or at least activity that cannot be proved to be criminal. And it drowns out the reports which are indicative of criminal activity. So we've got a hugely inefficient system where the financial institutions report suspicious activity, most of which is not criminal, and the enforcement agencies and regulatory agencies are overwhelmed by the data and don't spot the real warning signs. And I think, therefore, that if we can put in place a clearinghouse approach where the state and the commerce work in harmony together in that environment and share their data, and it would have to be anonymized in a way to which didn't recognize individuals or corporate entities, but allowed individual perhaps to be allocated a number or a nom de plume, which allowed you to recognize criminal activity and then to apply for a court order once that had been established. So I think those are two big areas I would argue that need real attention. Thinking about insider threat and what systems are in place. And number two is data sharing, which I think can make a real difference for the future. But thank you for listening, and I look forward to any questions answered later, and I'll hand over.
Thank you for that, Bernard. There are so many things in there that are topical around the future state of our kind of anti-financial crime efforts as an economy, as a society, and clearly there are things that need to change and that will change, as you've said. So thank you for that. Hopefully some of the themes that we'll talk about now in these slides will definitely link to those that you've raised there and that Fran raised earlier. And next slide, thanks, Emma. So obviously these slides were created in the pandemic. So they're tinged by some of the things that Bernard was talking about, that when we talk about being in the office, of course, we're talking about being in our virtual office in the main. And so some of those things, like the insider threat, are modified by the fact that we are, and our staff in many of the organizations represented here on the call today, are working from home. And so it modifies, sometimes increasing, the threats that are represented in relation to things like insider threat and some of the cybercrime aspects of the insider threat. Of course, Fran has mentioned earlier around the fraud numbers and how they have increased, particularly around impersonation scams. Some would say that the fraud that is out there, the total fraud hasn't increased, it's just changed and taken advantage of the narratives that fit with the pandemic. But certainly the UK, as Fran has said, and the UK finance figures quoted, show that there has in fact been an increase in fraud. And as Bernard was saying, so much of it with a cyber element. And so these things and the series that we've got over the coming month or so really speak to the if you drew a Venn diagram, the link between financial crime and data and cybercrime, and obviously the ability to prosecute. Next slide, thanks, Emma. Back in the day, we've talked about this before, the to what extent did we see the pandemic coming? You're probably all fed up of hearing about the pandemic, but it looks like it's continuing, doesn't it? And so the risks that are increased as a result of us working from home, some of those anticipated by the public-private threat update from last year. So more on, it's just been sped up, really. The more online access, more data being shared online, more opportunities for the abuse of identity, and the insider threat that Bernard was talking about, potentiated by the fact that potentially people have less oversight if they're working from home. Next slide, thanks, Emma. Now, you've got the opportunity to use slido.com. Again, hashtag FinCrime, if you've got your mobile phones handy and you want to vote on this particular question. To what extent have you seen a change in the level of fraud attempts against your organization during pandemic? So has it increased, has it reduced, or is it the same? You have got the opportunity to respond via slido.com, hashtag FinCrime, if you have your mobile phones available to you, or if you're doing it online even. I suppose if we were to think about that, fraud attempts against your organization, including your organization's customers who you deal with and whose fraud sometimes you have to deal with, might be a slightly different answer. I suppose the biggest thing I take away from that, we're not recording who is answering what questions. You're not going to suddenly find me contacting you talking about the answer that you gave, but just as an aside. The most interesting thing about the response from my point of view is the fact that nobody's saying it's less. And so it looks like Fran's going to continue to be busy. But for the rest of us who have to deal with the fraud threats and the threats against our organizations and our organization's customers, that means that we have to be even more vigilant and even more focused on dealing with the threats as they change and as they morph and as they increase over time. So interestingly, I suppose it's kind of a hot topic. As some of you know, I'm involved in one of those public-private and private-private enterprises that Bernard referenced earlier, and it's called Stop Scams UK. And I always give them a plug because they're doing great work on a small budget to try and improve our response as a society and as an economy to fraud. Born out of some of the people that were involved in the contingent reimbursement model, but understanding that that wouldn't be a panacea and an answer to all ills, and that we needed to try and improve some of the anti-fraud infrastructure. And that is developing. And there are quite a few core members, mainly members of the banking community and the telecoms industry, but there are more joining from other industries, hopefully some of the insurance industry. As Bernard was saying earlier, in many ways, one of the things that StopScams wants to promote is the sharing of data. And there are things that certainly the banking industry can learn from how insurers, both general insurers and life and pensions companies, share data. So it'll be interesting to see how that develops. So if you get the opportunity to get involved in StopScams UK, then do that. It's sponsored by Ofcom and FCA. One of the things that's quite interesting and has been referenced by Fran is the vulnerability of our customers to use of text messages. It's somehow become a key part of how we communicate with our customers, whereas telecoms companies would say it isn't a very secure method of communication, and yet it forms the basis of quite a lot of banks' secure communications with customers. Now, setting aside how that happened, you'll see more of the modern payment institutions and quasi-banks using communication from inside their apps on people's phones to communicate with customers without trying to rely so much on SMS messaging. But it is interesting, isn't it, even from how government communicates with us, that even yesterday I had a text message purporting to be from government about the use of track and trace. I think most of you on this call would have had that. And inside that was a clickable link. Now, if anybody of you have listened to the views of Katie Worrebeck, who's the head of financial crime for UK Finance, who highlighted the last time government did that at the beginning of the pandemic, and was rightly, I think, critical of that. It doesn't seem like we've learned much of a lesson, really, that we continue to promote that method of communication to the populace, when really the fraudsters following up and using that narrative and that method of communication in order to, as Fran talked about, obtain information from customers and even getting them through to making payments to destinations that make those funds irrecoverable, and sometimes at great personal cost to the victim. So really, we do need to think about how we're going to get away from doing that. And as I say, some of the more modern payment firms are probably weaning themselves off SMS as a method of communication with their customers. Next, thanks, Emma. Of course, there are many ways of communicating with customers. The government is trying to promote some of its schemes to be cyber aware, watching out for the trade tax refund scams, and really trying to promote education of consumers. There's definitely work, I think, that could be done on that. And I know some of the institutions represented on this call have kind of take control of that narrative in many ways and have their own ways in which they communicate with customers about how customers should expect to communicate with them. And some more successful than others, but some really are making a fist at trying to tell customers the right way to communicate with them and how that can continue. I mean, as for stop scams, which I'm involved in, there are definitely some good propositions which they are going to promote, which you will see over the next six months, which try to wrest control away from the fraudsters in trying to intercept communications or masquerade as institutions to our consumers. And there are really going to be some developments there which try and wrest away control from those who have a kind of malign intent. So watch out for the release of some of those initiatives, which really should make a difference and are a product of good public-private and private-to-private cooperation. One of the people who gave us a question before this session asked us to talk about successful government schemes. Well, I can't talk necessarily to government schemes, but I can tell you that there are some that StopScams are involved in that will have some tangible benefits. It's well trailed, isn't it, that in the fraud environment there are some things that could be done in a better way, and Bernard has referenced a number of those, and particularly intelligence sharing. And I know that there is work ongoing that some of you will be aware of around trying to make sure that the legal framework actually supports the sharing of data in the many, many circumstances in which you as organisations would like to both contribute to and benefit from the sharing of data between yourselves. Now, clearly, there are lots of people that would have lots of concerns about that type of sharing of data. But I do know that I have it on good authority that there is work currently being done to assess what changes would need to be made to the legal framework to cover those circumstances and to make sure that the best way to defeat a network is to have a great network between ourselves. And so there is work to try and make sure that that is facilitated by the legal framework. Next, thanks, Emma. Another one. Are you currently involved in the public-private or private-private anti-financial crime program? If you wouldn't mind responding on Slido, hashtag FinCrime. They are desperate for your involvement. So if you want me to point you in the direction of some of those, then please do reach out to me. And if I can facilitate your involvement, then I will do. It's not always about the money and the contribution that you might make. Your time and your expertise are as, if not more, valuable. And so if you're not involved in one and you want to be involved in one, then do reach out to me and I will try to get you involved if you'd like to be involved, certainly in the ones I know about anyway. Okay, well, that's good to see that there are some that are interested. Okay, so the future state, we've talked about it across this call. We need better collaboration between ourselves, as Bernard was saying, better use of analytics in all its forms, both the use of publicly available data, the tools used to analyze data, and the use of the data that we as individual firms hold on customers to protect them and to protect the institutions that we represent. And I know Bernard referenced some of the changes made whilst he was involved in law enforcement. I think there's more of that to come to kind of organise both, you know, the law enforcement agencies and the other institutions involved to try and make sure that if there is a levy, that those funds are deployed in a way where we get our best bang for our buck in our anti-financial crime efforts. Next slide, please, Emma. I think this is my final question. Would a financial crime levy, so we talked about the levy in the consultation, impact your expectations to how your involvement would be funded? So if you were going to get involved in the public-private partnership, would you expect the fact that you're paying a levy to mean that you wouldn't want to contribute in a separate way to it? And the reason for this question is really about displacement. A lot of firms represented on this call invest in various initiatives. And I'm trying to get a sense of whether your organization's payment of a levy would, in your mind, displace the need for you to contribute separately. So I know maybe a complex thing to analyze in your own minds in such a short space of time, but I am interested because I really want us to avoid, if we're going to have a levy, it being the panacea for all ills and being thought of in that way. That's really interesting. I think that's the most interesting response I've seen so far. It's a real spread. Obviously impacted by the question. Some of you aren't involved in them, but some of you are. And so it's an interesting question. Feel free to continue voting on that one. Emma, if we could go on to the next slide, we maybe come back to that one. Thank you. Because we've got some questions. If we could go on to the next slide, I've got some slides in here which some of you have seen before, methodologies, some of the things that we think you should be doing in the pandemic whilst we're increasing our involvement in working from home, particularly oversight there. Bernard referenced the kind of oversight that you would have if you're in the office, but equally the behaviour of people using their computers online whilst involved in your work is also important, and also furnishes your organisation with some MI that helps you to understand how your staff are behaving. Next slide. Thanks, Emma. That was great. Next slide. Thank you, mate. Now, some of the ways that GT can help, you know, the normal advertising you get from me. You can move on to the next slide. Thanks, Emma. I think we're heading towards questions and answers. So we've got 7 minutes. So there have been some questions that have come in. And let's see, there might be some that have come in via, these are ones that have come in from Slido, I think, Emma. And Fran, I don't know, whilst I've been wittering on, whether you've had a chance to look at some of those.
I haven't, although I see one from John, how extensive is the use of mules in the various types of financial crime? Can you tell us more about mules? I'm happy to take that one. The use of mules onshore and offshore is extensive. Money laundering is about concealment and layering and using third-party bank accounts and giving somebody a percentage in order to use their bank account to launder the proceeds of crime is common in all variables of fraud cases and financial crime. So I would say you would find in most fraud cases there is a mule element to it.
Yes, it's a difficult... I mean, I worked at a firm on the comment for a year where... we dealt with this, we had to deal with this problem and exacerbated by the fact that more and more people open their accounts online, and the controls in the setting up of online accounts sometimes haven't been as strong as they could otherwise have been. And once a mule account is set up, there are things that you can do to try and offboard some of those. There are some people out there who are very good on the profiling of mule accounts who can help with that type of thing. But they are in a lot of, if you were to say there are 50 or so customer fraud typologies, mule accounts feature in quite a number of them. And I know that there are participants involved on this call who are signed up to the, I think it's the Vocalink, a MasterCard system that has been set up to try and help banks deal with the use of mule accounts as money zips between the different accounts before it goes offshore, to try and put a brake on those. So there are people that have thought about that one, have tried to mitigate against some of the worst aspects of mule accounts, but it is an ongoing problem. And I know from people that I'm involved in, that it is not something that is particular to the UK. In some of the other, particularly in some of the countries like Singapore and Hong Kong, they have similar problems to the problems we have.
I think the other thing to think about as well, of course, is that in organised crime, including economic crime, particularly around drugs, is the movement of cash. So people move drugs one way and they move the cash the other. So even within the UK, it's quite a good idea for police forces to concentrate on people travelling on the trains and coaches into and out of London, as an example, where large amounts of cash would be moved to avoid sometimes currency control, but more often to conceal organised crime.
Yeah. I mean, that is interesting that you mention currency controls. Definitely, that has come up a few times in my career, and very recently, and it always seems to involve South Africa. But I think you're probably talking about ones that are more closer to us geographically than South Africa. But that's an interesting piece of insight. Thanks, Bernard.
Yeah. It's also worth thinking about for the big financial institutions as well. Some of the banks have been caught cold around some of their outposts being used to move large amounts of cash in businesses that can't sustain that level of, can't explain that level of cash transfer. And it's a cover-up for the movement of illicit.
Yes, certainly. I mean, we all know of the Mexican one, where that was absolutely a feature that led to lots of foreign regulatory action against one of our main banks.
I think it goes back to that training thing, is for staff to be prepared to call stuff out where, you know, if they happen to be on a retail bank and they're on the counter, large amounts of cash are flowing. It's a symptom. It's not always true to say that financial crime is involved, but it's looking for the unusual and for staff to feel confident to call it out.
Yeah.
Sorry, Tom, I was just going to take one. There's one on the push payment fraud. How can we tackle push fraud if the bank customers are approving the payment transfers? Essentially, education, and it's educating your customers around how they are susceptible to fraud. It emanates from their emails being hacked, so it does go back to the customer. So if they have the right software, malware, and so on, to make sure they're on a robust system and not left vulnerable to a hack, then that will affect the rest of the chain, which is where the fraudster is able to present an opportunity where they approve the payment transfer.
I agree with that, Fran. I mean, it's a contentious area, but I think it's said that 90% of scamware attack can be prevented by merely updating your proprietary security software. But there's no incentive to do that. I think, yeah, to your point, I think if financial institutions said, well, of course we will compensate, or we'll compensate to a certain level, provided you have kept up to date your software, but we might reduce that level of compensation should you've only got level 4 when the 5th version has come out yesterday.
I see there's a
for the insurance industry, I think.
Very good. See, there's a question. Aside from text messaging, SMS, what other methods of communication are available to banks, organisations, businesses? Well, I did make reference to some of the more modern payment organisations, and I don't want to name them because I wouldn't want to necessarily suggest that they are the panacea for anti-financial crime controls necessarily. But though some of those institutions force the use of in-app comms. So if you want to approve a particular transaction, rather than it being an approval via a number that has come into your mobile phone via text message, they're forcing you to go into your app on the same phone where the bank is in, or the institution is in control of the security perimeter, and to approve it in the app. So there are a number, at least three of the institutions I bank with are currently doing that, and it's the more traditional banking institutions that have yet to embrace that. But as I understand it, there is likely to be more of that deployed rather than less. On the company registration, I mean, and I think I'm in the camp of the more accurate publicly available information and data around company formation that is available online in society, the more we have control over the use of legal vehicle, of commercial vehicles for the purposes of financial crime. It's not the panacea, it's not going to solve all ills, but I'm definitely in favour of more transparent publication of data. It's got to be kept, it's got to be secure, it's got to be accurate, it's got to be maintained, and there's got to be investment in order to make sure that that happens. And I'm in favour of that, but of course it comes at a cost to our government institutions. But I think it has a great, you know, it is essential for you as private organisations to be able to access some of that data, so that you can make the inquiries that you need to make when onboarding or reviewing the status of a customer.
It's vitally important as well, of course, that they know the ultimate beneficial ownership of any data. And that's had various ups and downs, internationally as well as domestically. But without it, it proves very difficult to anticipate a problem or deal with it should it arise.
Yes. I mean, you would know, Bernard and Fran and many on the call, some of these arrangements of the setup are so deliberately complex, which makes the tracing of money difficult, which makes the identification of the real ownership of it very difficult to understand and ascertain. And sometimes we look at these things through the lens of ownership in a very Anglo-Saxon way, when some of the culture of ownership doesn't map to the way we think of it. And I believe more information is better, but even then it doesn't entirely solve the problem. And I've certainly come across. I've been involved in a few engagements at the moment where that complexity is quite difficult to penetrate because of the lens I might bring to it in terms of what ownership is and how it is shared between people. I don't know whether, Bernard, whether you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think the big thing for me is that, I suppose, the open question is why are things so complex when generally we all strive for simplicity? And there are usually, there can be good reasons why we have complexity, you know, that there's just a commercial model that
rationale for shared ownership and that kind
of thing. Yeah, so it can be. But yeah. I think, you know, at the less challenging end of the market is probably tax reduction, which is something that, you know, everybody tries to get, obviously, to not pay as little tax as possible, I guess, to tax avoidance through to cover up for some, you know, definite criminality. And I suppose it's where it sits on that spectrum, really. So sometimes it's entirely innocent, and, you know, it's just the fact that international commerce requires international arrangements that, you know, do require complex things. I think everybody understands that. But I think where we see complexity, which is beyond the complexity of the business, then I think it's usually an indicator of something else going off, and you've then got to question motive.
Yeah. That's brilliant. Fran, any thoughts on that?
Well, I can see that we're actually coming up to 11:05. So
you're keeping us honest.
I am. I'm mindful that we don't want to keep people any longer. So I'm sorry to those people who entered questions and we've not been able to answer them. But we will have future sessions and you can ask questions. And we have a slide with our contact details on there. So if you want to contact us directly, please feel free to drop any of us an email and ask your question directly.
Brilliant. Yes, thank you so much to our contributors today, both to Fran and to Bernard, and to Emma, Layla, Hitesh, and the team who helped put this together. And thank you all so much for your patience as attendees and for your contribution on Slido and in submitting questions. That was really, really interesting. Thank you so much. I should add a plug for the rest of the series. There's another slide in here. There are, I think, four other sessions in this series, investigations. There's a reg update, cyber and data protection, all very germane to financial crime as it happens. It's almost like we planned it. But do, if you get the chance, come along to those sessions. And thank you very much for your participation today and patience. Thank you.